Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome back to the KK Zone. As always, I am your host, Kara Kaufman, coming at you on this Wednesday, February 24th. It is the middle of the first full week of spring training with the full squad, and things are getting fun. So I said last time that spring training is pretty boring, and that's true to some extent. But on the other hand, because we're ramping up slowly to baseball activities and there's not a lot of serious stuff going on, there is room for plenty of fun. And that's what we're gonna start this week, with fun, because who doesn't love fun? I do. So, my thinking this week, as I'm watching all these tweets from the Yankees and the players, and actually all of MLB, goofy photos, people getting back together, haven't seen each other in months, reuniting teammates, all these things, it makes me think, spring training is the freshman week of college, but for everybody. I mean, I don't know about your college, but where I went, freshmen have their own orientation week, but a lot of times as an upperclassman, you come back and you spend that week on campus anyway, because you can. And what's more fun than hanging out on campus with all your friends without any actual work to do? Now, obviously there is actual work to do during spring training. They've got to prep for the season. That's plenty of work. I am by no means diminishing or belittling the amount of work necessary to get yourself into shape to play major league sports. That said, the amount of work versus the amount of time, the proportion is just different, shall we say, than during normal year. Because once you're in the course of the season, first of all, you're playing games that count. Things that results are really important. During spring training, not so much. The games are just to get you into shape. And second of all, during spring training, you're all, well, everyone except whoever lives in the spring training city, in the Yankees case, Tampa, everybody else is living in their non-hometown, in temporary housing, kind of all nearby each other. Sounds like a dorm setup to me. Whereas when you're during a regular season, most of the players have settled in New York with their families. So, you know, outside of being in the stadium together during games and before games, you have your own life going on. During spring training, not so much. So, it just has the vibes of, first of all, you got the freshmen, the new players coming to a new team for the first time, a little nervous, don't know where the lockers are, you don't know where the right field to go is or where anything is. Very freshman energy. And then you've got all the long-term cool kids who've been there forever. Aaron Judge rolling back in the spring training, very comfortable, knows where everything is, knows who everyone is, and gets to just hang out with his friends while he gets back into baseball shape. I love this. When you get back to college after being away from your friends all summer, it's fun to look around and see who's changed. Who's got a new look, who's got some new hobbies and interests, who's turned over a new leaf in various ways, who has new teeth. What, new teeth? That thing? Apparently it's a thing. So Aaron Judge. If we even know Aaron Judge, very tall, very handsome, wonderful man with very distinctive, imperfect teeth, which is great. They were definitely a part of his look, a lot of fun. Apparently over the offseason, he decided to get a new set of teeth. With full veneer job going on, they are now perfect chiclet teeth. Take a look here, the before and the current. Massive change. Although, most interesting to me is I did not at first notice this. It took a moment for me to clock that something was very different. It makes a huge difference. I mean, I think Judge looks great both ways. So, my take on this is whatever makes him happy makes me happy, but new teeth award goes to Aaron Judge with no runner-up. No contest. What a fun one. Something else you do when you see people you haven't seen in a while is you fall back into your old ways. Jokes, inside jokes, and games and pranks. So my favorite prank this week comes courtesy of Baby Glaber and Gio Urshela. For whatever reason, Glaber had a lot of energy. He's young. Decided to give Gio Urshela a bit of a scare. So you got Gio coming out of the dugout, ready for batting practice, just as you normally do. Nothing great about that. Glaber sees him coming, sees the camera on him because he's a little bit of a ham in a really fun way. Hides, and then as Gio comes up the dugout steps, Glaber jumps out, causing Gio to basically jump back in surprise. Which, is that really dumb? It's really dumb, but I also find it really sweet. I love when they're friends. You're probably gonna hear me say that a lot as I do these videos, because one of my favorite things about sports is when it seems like players have actual, real camaraderie. Not just we play well and have good chemistry on the field, but we actually hang out and do fun stuff. I got a huge kick last year out of, after the Yankees were sadly eliminated, Gerrit Cole and Masahiro Tanaka and their wives went out to dinner, and I thought, that's so sweet, they like each other. So I love when they're friends, and to me, Gleyber Torres giving Gio Urshela a jump scare for no obvious reason, perfect, fits right into that mold, they're friends. I couldn't get the video, but this is the screenshot of just Glaber jumping up and scaring Geo in a really goofy way. Loved that. And something else, who's got a new vibe? Like, who's coming to school with a new attitude? And I gotta say, for me, this year, I think it's Clint Frazier. So Clint Frazier, I feel like, is polarizing and or underappreciated, but last year, he was great. He came in with a ton of hype, and you can see why, the tools are huge. He also came in with some random controversy. I mean, when the first thing that happens is there's a haircut story about you, that's not great. But to Clint's great credit, he has done nothing but perform. And when, in 2019, he had a lot of struggles in the field, but last year he hit well, and he was a Gold Glove finalist in left field. So Clint has really, really emerged, and he has been named the starting left fielder by Aaron Boone. So that's really exciting. And I do feel like he's starting to feel a lot more comfortable with who he is and his place in the organization. So two things about Frazier stood out to me this week. The first is this photo from the Yankees official Twitter account, which is, what is this? This is just two dudes pausing whatever they were doing to model. So that's Clint Frazier and Tyler Wade. My detour on this is that Tyler Wade, if I had to name in a yearbook superlative most likely to have a side career in modeling, I think I'm going Tyler Wade on this one. He just always looks so cool in his photos. He's got that very like all-American handsome vibe, and I feel like he loves a camera. You know, and it's great. It's fun for us because we get all these great shots. But this one is just two cool dudes leaning on their bats, just hanging out in the outfield. I love. And then Clint Frazier, again, then the next day, we get this amazing entrance video. Clint Frazier arriving for photo day, dressed in this outfit. I can't even really describe this. You're just gonna have to look at it. How fun is that? You know, basketball is big in fashion. The guys always have photos taken of them as they come in. They're wearing really cool clothes. We all know about the sneakers. Baseball players hasn't really been as much of a thing, but there are a lot of young, fun dudes who are trying to mix it up and show some of their fun style. So to me, this is the epitome of that. This is Clint Frazier wearing whatever that is and just owning it. The best part of this, of the video that this screenshot came from, is as Frazier walks in, the camera's on him, he's feeling good, loving the outfit. You see the camera pans slightly to a little golf cart, two guys in full Yankee uniform hanging out in it. One of them is Jordan Montgomery, and he just says, "You look great, man." I love it, because you know what? Clint did look great, and thank you, Monty, for pointing it out. That was delightful. So those are my fun, like, back-to-school vibe noticings of this week. That's a lot of fun. And now on to our second order of business this week. It is time to talk about starting pitching. This is the thing that seems to be the most talked about item on every team pretty much every season, and certainly the Yankees have been no exception. What's the deal with the starting pitching? So let's look at what we have going on here. And this is particularly big for the Yankees, because I'm gonna read this. So last year, the Yankees played 60 games. Everyone played 60 games. And here on this card, I have who led the Yankees in starts. So with 12 starts, number one was Gerrit Cole. The next two with 10 each were Masahiro Tanaka and Jordan Montgomery. After that, with 9, was Jay Happ. Then after that was Davey Garcia with 6, James Paxton with 5, Michael King with 4, Jonathan Loaisiga with 3, and Clark Schmidt with 1. So that adds up to 60, I promise. Now, of that group, the Yankees have since lost in free agency James Paxton, who went back to the Mariners, Jay Happ, who latched on with the Twins, and my personal fave, Masahiro Tanaka, who went back to the Golden Eagles in Japan. Wishing Masa nothing but the best, we'll seriously miss him. But, I mean, Paxton was hurt a bit last year, but that's 24 of the Yankees' 60 starts, so 40% of those starts they had last year, gone. So obviously a big story was how they're going to replace them, and we have some answers. There were some trades made, there were some players signed, so trying to predict the Yankees' starting rotation, let's do this lightning round style. Okay, they need 5 starters. Could they go with 6? They could. They've said they probably won't, so we're going to ignore that possibility for the moment. Just know that whichever 5 we end up talking about here, there are going to be plenty more. Inevitably, injuries happen, fatigue happens, you want to make sure someone gets a spot start to give someone an extra day of rest. It's going to be, you know, 9, 10, 12, who knows. But, starting 5. So, I would say, and this is all conjecture from me, 4 people are absolute locks. Here we go, number 1, Gerrit Cole. You know him, you love him. The Yankees' ace. Hands down, period, that's it. They signed him before last season. He is one of the absolute best pitchers in the game. Couldn't be happier. And I feel like because last season was so weird, I kind of forgot how excited I was that we signed Gerrit Cole. He came in with a lot of hype, and then obviously everything got derailed because of COVID. And then it came back for the actual season, and he was great. He was really, really good last year. A little bit homer prone, but you know, who hasn't been in the past couple years? And to be honest with you, looking back at his numbers last year, they were fantastic. Couldn't be happier to have Gerrit Cole. So if you ask me one fun thing about Gerrit Cole, ooh, I know. So wine. This is not really breaking news. Everyone knows this about him now, but Gerrit Cole is a wine aficionado. The Yankees, in fact, when they were trying to pitch him on coming to the Yankees, got him some very nice bottle of wine that he had had in Italy with his wife on a previous trip. He was very impressed. Suffice to say, if you need a wine recommendation, Gerrit Cole is the person to ask. He is a lock for starting rotation, number one starter. I'd expect him to start opening day if, knock on wood, he stays healthy and everything stays on track. Yay, Gerrit. Number two. Okay, we've got a new addition here. The Yankees went out and signed Corey Kluber. So Corey Kluber spent many years with the Indians. In fact, as a Yankees fan, my main memory of Corey Kluber is the 2017 ALDS, in which the Yankees were down 0-2, lots of shenanigans, won the next two in dramatic fashion, and then we came into Game 5, they had Corey Kluber starting, and we thought, well, he's really good, this is going to be a challenge. And what happened? Didi Gregorius, two home runs off Corey Kluber, puts the game away early. Great memory for us. Probably not as great for Corey Kluber. But the reason that was so notable is that Corey Kluber was absolutely fantastic. He was one of the best pitchers in the game in sort of the 15, 16, 17 kind of time. He has since been traded to the Rangers and then was hurt and really didn't pitch last year at all. I think one inning before he got hurt and was out for the season. So kind of a reclamation project is Corey Kluber. But the Yankees signed him. Obviously, the upside is tremendous. If he can stay healthy, and this is going to be the refrain with all these guys, pitchers break, but if he can stay healthy, he has the potential to be a real, real game changer. Very excited about Corey Kluber. The most fun thing I can think of about Corey Kluber is that his nickname is Klubot. Klubot. He apparently is very emotionless and just extremely focused, so he comes off like a robot. So between Klubot and DJ LeMahieu, the machine, we're going to have some seriously robotic humans wandering around, but also that they're that way because they are incredibly competitive and very, very focused. So super excited to see what Corey Kluber can do. If he can stay healthy, he'll certainly be in the starting rotation for the Yankees. Okay, so next up, the Pirates. The Pittsburgh Pirates have been pretty bad for a while. Sorry, Pittsburgh fans. And they're likely to be pretty bad for a little while longer going forward. So they've been trading some of their good players like it's going out of style. One of those players who the Yankees managed to procure is Jameson Taillon. And that's exciting. If we all recall way back in memory bank, Gerrit Cole was also a Pirate back in the day. So he and Taillon were not only rotation mates, but they were buddies. They were roommates, they were friends. So that's pretty neat to reunite those two. And Taillon has really, really strong potential to be excellent. But he too has been hurt. In fact, he is coming off Tommy John surgery. So he's on track. He's healthy. He looks healthy. Knock on wood. I'm just keep knocking on my head this entire episode. But he's tweaked some stuff in his delivery because he's had Tommy John surgery twice, which is far less than ideal. So he realized he might have to change something to make sure he can keep his elbow intact. He's done that. Now, spring training, one of the many great things about spring training is it's full of, I tweaked something and it's going to make me a new pitcher, a new player kind of thing. And we'll see if this actually does bear fruit. But in any event, we have Jameson Taillon, and provided he stays healthy, he'll be in the Yankees rotation. I'm pretty excited about him. He seems like a lot of fun so far. His interviews have been really great. He seems excited to be in New York. My fun fact about him, I'm pretty sure I heard this right. He has some kind of coffee blog where he'll take photos of coffee outside the coffee shops and post them on Insta. That sounds fun, and sounds like he'll fit right in New York. Just take a trip to Brooklyn. You can swing through all the cool coffee shops, Jameson. Like, have a great time. So we're excited to have him. Yay! And then the fourth and final lock for the rotation, obviously pending good health, is returning member Jordan Montgomery. So I'm a big Jordan Montgomery fan myself. He had a great, great rookie campaign. He came out of nowhere to seize that fifth starter spot a couple years back, he was great. And then he had Tommy John. So he had a long way back, but he is back now. He pitched last season, as I noted earlier, and he's a nice, big, tall lefty. He gets by with location and pitching smarts, he mixes it up with a good mix of pitches. I'm personally, I'm always optimistic on Monty. He wasn't as great last season as I'd hoped, though he did have some really good moments and some really bad ones. But I am bullish. I think he's going to be a difference maker. And again, provided that he can stay healthy, he will also definitely be in the rotation. So we've got Gerrit Cole, Corey Kluber, Jamison Tyone, and Jordan Montgomery. That's a pretty good top four. I'm into it. Then you might ask Kara, you said there will be five, and there will be, but who's the fifth one? This is one of the few, very few, fully wide open competitions in Yankees camp. I got a couple of possibilities here, and I'm gonna just blow through them real quick. So my personal favorite idea here is Davey Garcia. I love Davey Garcia. Davey is one of the Yankees' top prospects, but he actually did pitch last season, and he pitched pretty darn well last season. He is the kind of guy who just is exciting to watch. So he's got a non-classic pitcher's build in that he's pretty small, but he throws a devastating curveball and just competes with extreme grit and intensity. So I'm super high on Davey Garcia. He was pretty good last year, and that terrible playoff game that the Yankees lost to the Rays was by no fault of his. They had him back as an opener for Hap, which went poorly for both. But I really think if they just let Davey run, he could have been really good. So I'm excited to let them see what he can really give this season. Now, he's probably got an innings limit, because everyone probably is, coming off of such a low workload last season. But I think David Garcia is super exciting, and that's my hope, is that he emerges the victor in this fifth starter competition. Another option we have is Domingo Germán. So Domingo Germán was excellent for the Yankees in 2019. He was really, really effective, one of their most consistent starters. I think he led the team in wins, but he then had to serve a suspension for domestic abuse. Now, I'm not gonna give this too much time. I find this whole situation really rather upsetting, and a very large part of me wishes that I didn't have to even think about what he'd done because the Yankees hadn't brought him back. There's really no place for domestic violence or abuse anywhere in the world, and certainly not on the biggest stage in baseball. That being said, it's not my decision, and he is in camp, so he has not pitched in a year plus. The question is what he looks like now, and we don't know that yet. Obviously, the Yankees need pitching, so if he looks good, they're going to use him, so we'll see. He certainly is a contender for that fifth rotation spot. We will have to see what happens. So those are my top two picks to claim that last starter spot in the rotation, but there are a couple other dark horse options, one of whom is Mike King. So Mike King has been a Yankee for a long time in the minor leagues. He has made a couple of big league appearances in the past 2 years. It's been limited big league time to kind of mixed results, but he definitely has potential, and he's been really good in the minors. So if he impresses in spring training, wouldn't shock me to see him end up at a fifth starter spot, but I do think it's a little bit of a long shot. We shall see. And then the Yankees did bring in sort of veteran insurance in Yoli Chacin, who we will see what he can bring. He's pitched recently for the Braves, for the Red Sox, definitely a veteran who can give you some innings. Are they going to be good innings is the question. So he is with the Yankees on a minor league contract. He's in camp, obviously, and we'll see. He probably has an opt-out at the end of spring training, so if he doesn't make the team, I doubt he'll stick around. But if injuries hit, and certainly that has been a thing that's happened, or if he looks really, really good in camp, wouldn't be totally shocked to see him start out as a fifth starter either. This is maybe the most dark horse of all these candidates, but Nick Nelson is somebody a lot of the Yankees beat writers have been talking about a ton. So he was with the team last year. He made his major league debut during the shortened season. He worked out of the bullpen for the Yanks. And there's a lot to like. He's got some really, really good stuff. He also at moments struggled to control it a bit and had some rough outings, but you know, it was his cup of coffee in the majors. So there's a lot of excitement about the potential he brings. I say he was in the bullpen, he was, but all through his minor league career, he's been a starter. So I would be shocked if the Yankees hadn't had him prepare as a starter over the offseason and see what he brings into camp. So I would be unsurprised to see him end up in the minor leagues starting until a depth need opens up. I would not be surprised to see him in the major league bullpen as a reliever, although because he has options in the minors, that maybe isn't the most likely place. Or if, you know, if he ends up really impressing, he could pull a Jordan Montgomery and be the surprise fifth starter. The kid's got a lot of potential. It could be really fun to watch. Okay, so that pretty much wraps up the options. There is one name that was not mentioned, and that is one of the Yankees' top pitching prospects, Clark Schmidt. I mentioned him on a previous episode because he had the most enthusiastic greeting of anybody walking in for pitcher and catcher's reporting day. And he's great. We're really excited for him. He also pitched last year. I mentioned his name before when I was talking about who made starts. But Clark Schmidt, who I thought had an okay shot at this job, has been injured. Womp, womp. So I think all of us, myself included, have been moderately traumatized by the 2019 season in which every single Yankee got hurt. It ended up being a fun season. The next man up mentality really, really helped the guys tough it out. They ended up having a shockingly good season, considering multiple All-Stars spent multiple months on the injured list. That said, it also gives me a little bit of PTSD. Anytime anybody makes any face, isn't a smile, I assume that he's in pain and is promptly going to have some kind of limb removed or other serious surgery. So Clark Schmidt is the first injury in camp this year, and fortunately, it seems like it's not too bad. It's an elbow injury, which you hate to see in a pitcher, but it is not the UCL. So Schmidt has already had Tommy John. He had Tommy John when he was drafted, and he's come back from that. The Yankees say that that ligament in the MRI they did is fully intact. What they have is a strain of a different one, which seems as though it's probably going to be less of a recovery time. That said, he's being shut down 3 to 4 weeks, which basically eliminates any chance he will make the opening day roster in any capacity, because he'll need time to ramp up after that, and he'll be about a month behind everyone else. So I am hopeful, cautiously optimistic, that we'll see plenty of Clark Schmidt this season, but it will not be on opening day. That said, if he doesn't make at least a couple of starts, I will be very surprised. Now, news of Clark Schmidt's injury brings me to introduce a new segment that I had been really hoping not to introduce this early in the game, but here we go. Friends, this is going to be with us throughout the course of the season. It is the whiteboard of doom. Yep, it's a whiteboard. I have it right here. So, this is what I'm doing. I've got a little list here of all the Yankees' injuries. Probably can't read this. So it has been 2 days since the last workplace injury, unfortunately. Sad face. So we have right now, so 60-day IL here. We've already got someone on it, and that someone is Luis Severino. This is not a surprise. Luis had Tommy John last season. He missed the whole year. We missed him greatly. He is expected back at some point this summer. Seems so far, knock on all the wood, like his progress has been pretty good. There's no 15-day IL right now because of spring training. And then we've got this sort of other category, and that's where I've put Clark Schmidt. The Yankees have not announced any plans to put him on the 60-day IL to date, but here he is. He's got an elbow strain, and he is out 3 to 4 weeks. So that's that. This is going to be constantly updated. I mean, hopefully not constantly. I'm hoping it's rarely updated because the Yankees will get through a season in extremely healthy fashion, but one never knows. So yeah, whiteboard of doom for all your injury needs. So that is going to do it for this second spring training dispatch. The kids are all back in school, but classes haven't started yet, so I'm gonna keep on watching out for fun shenanigans on campus in the meantime. And on that note, I will leave you with this quote from Leslie Bricusse and Anthony Newley from The Roar of the Grease Paint and the Smell of the Crowd, and that is, it's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me, and I'm feeling good. I'm feeling good, the Yankees are feeling good, I hope you're feeling good, and I will see you next time. Until then, go Yanks!